So we've got three talks headed now, and Terry Serling is a co-convener of this meeting, and really it was a lot of his ideas that got me into this field to begin with. His papers early on were some of the most influential papers that I've read in my career, and his paper that just came out 6 months ago is, I think, really shaping our views of hominins in an environment that's in the midst of change. So, Terry's going to lead us away with some really stimulating work. So, Terry. So apparently, you have a clicker. There we go.
Okay. Thank you. The next three talks are me, Ben Passy, and Naomi Levin, and we were going to try to coordinate some of our efforts, but I think we forgot to do that. So I'm not sure what, if anything, will be overlapping between these talks. But together, we're going to be talking about using various aspects of stable isotope ecology in the various hominin environments, and what can we learn about that. And so I just wanted to lead off with something to would be, if you're a hominin wandering around the landscape, what would a day be like, and what are some of the things that a hominin would have to consider? The co-authors that are listed here, the first two are Sam Ondanje and Dave Kimtai are with Kenya Wildlife Service, and Will Mace is a student who's working on temperatures and soils. Anthony Macharia is a student who works on spatial modeling, and Chris Ramin is a math biology student at University of Utah. And I'll bring in some other things as well, but this particular project started a couple of years ago when Ben Passy, who will be speaking next, came up with some surprising results on something called the Delta 47. So this talk is based on his findings that there's a suggestion that hominids had fairly high temperatures to deal with, and he's going to discuss that in detail in the next talk. And I'm not going to say more about it except that we can now think about, can we talk about absolute temperatures in environments? Something's supposed to forward here. Some years ago, about 20 years ago, I was somewhere in East Africa, I think at Olduvai Gorge, and one of the paleoanthropologists asked me the surprising question. He handed me a tool, and he said, well, was the hominid, when he made this tool, was he sitting in the shade? And I remember telling him, well, if you can tell me the time of day, I can tell you whether he's sitting in the shade. But it kind of is kind of symptomatic of the field. In isotope geology and ecology, we keep getting asked, you know, really sometimes some really bizarre questions. And one of those is, can we talk about the shade? And so I'm going to talk for a while about the stable isotope composition of shade, as it were. Not quite as far-fetched as you might think. So, like I say, these are the questions that we're asked, and we can now address in some fashion all of these using stable isotopes, and it gives a quantification of the environment that paleoanthropologists have really long wanted to do. But I'll have to say, as we've done this, we've actually had to develop the rules for a lot of these, and so the study of the East African environments has in a way been a proving ground for many of the isotope methods that are used in terrestrial environments. So can we quantify shade? Here's three sites in East Africa. One is at 1% shade, 20% shade, and basically 99% shade. And we have to do a redefinition of shade to make it a useful thing, and Rowan Sage in his previous talk discussed this property of thinking about woody cover. And if we redefine shade as woody cover, then we see that maybe there's something that we can work with. And so there's always some people who aren't afraid to admit that they don't know what isotopes are. So I always throw in a little bit about what isotopes are. And you learned all of this in kindergarten, I'm pretty sure. And so this is just a reminder. Because, you know, you all know the periodic table of the elements, because you learned that in kindergarten, and you know that, you know, element number 26 is iron. So if we say, oh, it's 26 protons, you know that that's iron. And if it's, you know, 8, then you know it's oxygen, and so on. And the isotopes are just another dimension of the periodic table. And you could think of it in this direction. So hydrogen has 3 isotopes. Hydrogen 1, 2, and 3, they all have 1 proton, so they all act identical. And it's the neutron, the extra mass, that gives them the isotope properties. So we're just looking at different forms, as it were. And that makes them ideal tracers. If you want to study carbon in the environment, it's better to use carbon, even though silicon is below it on the periodic table. Carbon acts more like carbon than silicon. So we use the isotopes as our tracers. So, and our isotope terminology is our delta notation, and this will be carried through a course in the next talk. So the delta C13 is the ratio, carbon 13 to 12, in whatever it is we're looking at compared to some standard, and both are 99%+ carbon 12, and so it's a tiny number. So on Earth, the carbon 13 ranges from 1.04 to 1.14%, and that's 100 of these per mil units. Okay, so that's our playing field. So C3 and C4 plants, Rowan Sage talked about them in an isotope space. There was a discussion of the open and closed nature of them, but they're very nicely separated in isotope space. And this is a histogram of African plants that happened to be the one that I've analyzed in my lab for C3 plants and C4 plants. And there's a lot of interesting isotope ecological structure within the C3 plants and within the C4 plants, but we're mainly interested between the broad difference of this sort of average minus 27 or so per mil for C3 plants and minus 12 per mil or so for C4 plants. And in terms of going to a grocery store, this is the Mercado in Addis Ababa, the tomatoes and onions and bananas and all of those sort of things, again, that Rowan pointed out, the fruits and vegetables are all C3 plants. And the C4 plants, this is Ethiopian teff, a tiny, tiny, small-grained, small-seeded plant. And this is injera. So this is the way you eat today, eat teff. And okay, so this is this nice isotope distinction that is in the plant world, and we want to use that in the geological past to reconstruct things. So in terms of our shade problem, we've got trees, shrubs, and herbs as C3 plants, and tropical grasses as C4 plants. And this is a sort of a typical dry forest, lots of trees and shrubs. And actually, in this particular forest, there's some understory, but it turns out it's actually mostly herbs, C3 herbs, perhaps a few C4 grasses, and then a nice C4 grassland with some shrubby things and trees in the background. And so in redefining our terms, these are trees, shrubs are shade, and not shade, to make it a binary system, with our tropical grasses, and just to make our life a bit more complicated, are the herbs and forbs that are C3, but are present not only in the understory here, but if you wander out in the Serengeti Plain, which you are here, you'll find that there are a lot of herbs and forbs that are C3, even in this apparently C4 ecosystem. So to quantify this, what we did, and this is the paper that we recently, that just came out about 6 months ago in Nature, tried to quantify the fraction of woody cover, 1% here, and we did this in a variety of ways, measuring, writing down in your notebook, using high-resolution satellite imagery, taking fisheye photographs of so on in a variety of environments that range from 1% woody cover to 99% woody cover, and tried to quantify the isotope values, and did this by taking samples in the gap, so halfway between the canopy footprint, as it were, and canopy samples, and took stable isotope samples from each of these and brought them back to the lab and analyzed them. And the bottom line is this diagram showing the delta C13 of the canopy and the delta C13 of gap samples. So these are the soil samples collected from the gaps from the canopies, and a very strong correlation between them. And it kind of makes a fair amount of sense. And again, thinking back to Rowan's talk about this, as this canopy closes up, this gap becomes smaller and smaller, and there's less and less light getting in here. That's going to affect the temperature of the ground surface, which we're going to deal with in a bit more detail later. As the canopy gets taller, the same thing happens, is this becomes more and more shaded as the sun passes from the east to the west as it arcs across the sky. And so and we find that in a closed canopy where the gap is fairly small, then the gap samples look just like the canopy samples. And as we get to more and more open environments, we get under the canopy, we get more and more C4 plants, and it makes sense that as this opens up, we get more light underneath here. That favors C4 photosynthesis. The temperature will be warmer here than if the gap is totally closed, and so that we can now think about using this data then to quantify the delta C13 value with respect to the total canopy or gap cover. So our approach then was then to take weighted averages, take the, for a particular sample, particular soil system that usually was hundreds of meters in all directions, and took a delta C13 value for the gap samples, for canopy samples, and so on. So here's what it looks like from the sky, and those of you who are geology majors, think back to your petrology class where you are given this little card of what is the percent of magnetite in this sample, the little black things, and it turns out that when you actually measure these things, you tend to get a different number than your original visual estimate. So it does take some quantification, but this is typically 1%. This bush is that bush right there. This photo was taken from parking the car right here, and this photo was from right in here. So we've taken these matched photos and tried to quantify our canopy and gap and lots of soil samples in each of these kind of environments. And this is the data set from about 76 soils and a total of about 5,000 soil analyses from various places, about half in Africa and about half from other places in the tropics, which are strongly skewed actually to northern Australia. But we get this relationship between the C3 and the C4 ecosystems, and looking at these in soils, and the important thing to notice, it's not a linear mixing between the C4 or C3 end member and the C4 end member, which would be a line up here in the top. In fact, this illustrates that there's a large contribution of the forbs and the herbs in these open systems. And so our approach is that we can then, for any particular delta C13 value, we can calculate a probability density function for that value and apply that to estimating the woody cover from the delta C13 value. So what I'm going to show you is the results from some of our work and some other work on all of the paleosols that have been looked at in eastern Africa, at in particular those associated with hominin sites. So the paleosols in East Africa, this is a data set that is based on Naomi Levin's paper at the end of last year, and this is one of the things that we published in the Evolutionary Anthropology volume that just came out again last year. In taking the paleosol record from Lake Turkana and trying to estimate the fraction of woody cover from carbonates and paleosols. And so what that means is we have a translation from going from paleosol carbonate, which are preserved in paleosols like this one here, to calculating soil organic matter. And we take the soil organic matter and then estimate the fraction of woody cover. So in Turkana, so this is Lake Turkana region, we have two principal geographic areas we're considering. The green is the Shungura Formation in southern Ethiopia, and that's more in the basin axis. And on the flanks of the basin axis are the Nachikui and Kubifora formations, which are well exposed in Kenya. And what we see is that, first of all, there's a distinction before about 1.8 million years ago, and the basin axis is more wooded than the basin margins. But in any case, none of those are in what we might think would be a closed forest. So we go from this, what would be a grassy woodland or grassy bushland in Shungura, and in the Kenya part of the basin would be considered to be a wooded grassland. And as we march up in time, about 1.8 million years ago, they converge. And there's some important drainage basin changes that take place at this time that are not worth dwelling on, I think, for this. But basically, the system never returns to this original system where the Shungura basin axis soils are significantly different than the others. But the bottom line is that we never see evidence for pure open grasslands in the Turkana Basin. We see ample evidence for what would be considered wooded grasslands and perhaps grassy woodlands. And how does this play out then with respect to some other things? Oh, here's visually 21%, the one we've been looking at before. This is 40%. This is 65%. This is an 80% woody cover kind of environments. So 80% is here. We never see anything in the paleosols, at least, that look like that. We do see things in the 60s. And some of the important fossils from the Turkana Basin. If we look at the Omo Turkana Basin, we've done that in the previous couple of slides. So the dark blue here is the Nachikui Kubifora group, and the light blue is the Shungura Formation. We see perhaps, the numbers are a bit small, but we see perhaps that it was open, what would be wooded grasslands, become slightly more closed between about 4 and 2 million years ago, and then becomes more open again. And we see a similar thing in Ethiopia, where it looks like it becomes it's more open at 6 to 4 million years ago, becomes slightly more closed, but still would be considered to be wooded grasslands, and then becomes a little bit more open again as we go up higher in the sequence. This, by the way, is the Ardipithecus site that turns out to be one of the most open sites that we see anywhere, and isotopically to me looks like would be a grassland. But so we see this trend, but all environments indicate a fairly open habitat, at least back to about 6 million years ago, based on this paleosol evidence. If we expand the database, so now this includes all paleosols published as of last year, so the number is almost 1,400. So now this includes all of the data from Olduvai Gorge, from Oligocyli, from Kanjera, from Turkana Basin, Baringo Basin, Awash, everything associated with hominids younger than about 6 million years old from East Africa. And now we've parsed the delta C13 of the soils into the woody dicot fraction, okay, the C4 grasses, and the residual must be the C3 forbs and herbs. And now we could kind of consider, well, what is the fraction of these different environments? So on the order of about 25% of the paleosols would indicate something that could be as open as these environments. Less than 10% woody cover. And clearly, essentially none of those actually must have come from Turkana Basin because we didn't have evidence for pure grasslands. But that's about 25% of the total soils that have been looked at. What would be called wooded grasslands from about 10 through 20, 30, and 40% woody cover is about 60% of the paleosols. So now we're up to 85% of the paleosols, and woodland, shrubland, about 15% of paleosols. So from 40 through to about 80% woody cover, and for total forest, less than 1% of this number indicates full forest. So even if the paleosols are biased, this is what we have to work with if they're biased towards certain environments. So basically we're seeing almost all the paleosol evidence, 80%+ of the environments that are recorded in paleosols look like wooded grasslands to grasslands. So that would suggest that then the early hominid, the guy who's going to be wandering around on a day-to-day basis, is in this environment. So, by the way, here's two sites. This is the Arabuco, the Sokoke Forest. If this histogram here, which has had its numbers cut off, would be the delta C13 value of soils that we would get based on this environment. So this is sort of the C3, a pure C3 distribution. The lower Tana River at the Tana River Primate Reserve is in this region, and here's just a couple of blow-ups. So it has this beautiful riparian corridor, and then it has these more open habitats on the outside. And by the way, the floodplain here from valley walls, the valley wall, it's kind of hard to find the valley wall here, but the floodplain here actually is about, in the meander belt, is about 20 or 30 kilometers wide. So we're looking at only a very small fraction of this, and most of that looks like this. So the environment that would be preserved in the geological record of the lower Tana River is 95%+ this, and this narrow riparian corridor that's very, very important for many species is a very small portion of the whole thing. And this is the paleosol distribution that we would expect from this geographic square, which is 25 square kilometers. So this, rather not identical to, but similar to that sort of histogram. So the question is now, if we have this this heterogeneity of the landscape, which is what's being indicated by the paleosols, we can get to the question of how hot. And So the question is, well, what is the temperature? Lake Turkana is 29 degrees Celsius. Here's Nakuru at 17 degrees Celsius. And Ben Passy is going to give the next talk, and he's going to talk about a newly developed method to get absolute temperatures, which is, I think, safe to say, one of the, if you can have more than one holy grail of isotope geochemistry, it's getting absolute temperatures that you can wrest from the geological record. And so Ben is going to talk about that. But I'm going to say that what led the next part of our study was Ben's results. And that was, he said, it was really damn hot. So how hot is that? This gets back to the question of where were these guys, were they sitting in the shade when they made these tools? So this is from last September's Nature. But what we did to evaluate part of Ben's problem was to, at about 40 sites in Kenya, we put in the hobo temperature data loggers and put them in at a number of depths at 5, 15, and 25 centimeters depth, because we were interested in evaluating the deep soil temperature. And so we thought, well, if we do this, we can actually get more information out of this. And that's why we put them in at these depths. We can take the five centimeter depth, the 15 centimeter depth, and the 25 centimeter depth, and we can sort of use standard, not quite standard, but the notion of how to do this has been long in the diffusion soil or in the heat diffusion equations. Actually not assume that it's a simple sinusoidal input, which is normally done in geophysics, but to take these three data points and invert them to calculate the surface temperature that produces this profile. Okay, so we have this profile, these three profiles. We can calculate the unique input value to the surface of the soil that will give you these three values. And this is a typical soil temperature envelope. And the important thing to notice is that it's not symmetrical, it's asymmetrical. And it, in terms of the midpoint of the deep soil temperature, it gets much hotter at the surface than it gets colder. Okay, and that's kind of illustrated here. You can see the deep soil temperature here is about 36 degrees Celsius, and it's getting 10 degrees cooler, but it's getting much, much hotter. And so it's getting hotter for shorter periods of time is the way that it works out with respect to the soil diffusion. So Will Mace is, for his thesis that he's defending in about 3 weeks. This is the daily, so he took every single day for a year, and this is for the Meru National Park Tana River system. We have a grassland, a bush site, and a riparian forest. And he took the data from every single day. He calculated the input function that would produce what's preserved at depth. And so this is the soil input function. The blue is the grassland. The red is this bushland. And this green is the riparian forest. So we now have the daily input, and notice these are getting up to excess of 60 degrees Celsius sometimes for the ground surface temperature. Okay, so we thought that was odd, and we did some experiments up at Lake Turkana and at the TBI camp, and yep, it gets up, and some that we've recorded soil surface temperatures up over 70 degrees Celsius. It is hot. So this represents what Will Mace is calling the composite day. This is the composite day for June, July, August for these three environments. And these three environments are within less than a kilometer distance from each other. So in our open grassland, we are getting the soil surface temperatures. If you're actually sitting on the soil like only geologists seem to do in the middle of the daytime. You can get temperatures up to 60 degrees Celsius if you walk a few meters and get under even these scraggly bushes with no leaves on them. Your maximum temperature is 10 degrees Celsius cooler, and if you walk all the way over into this environment, you're going to be over here. So nice, nice place to be. So I've just blewed out, I guess, as it were, the 40 degrees Celsius window here for the grassland, and this is, it's too dark. So here's the window of time that's available if you to be out in the open grassland. And so where were the hominins sitting when they were making the tools? If they were as smart as goats, okay, they only have to be as smart as goats, and they would be in the shade in the middle of the day. So I think, we have a talk on evolution of brain size. So, yeah, so Rowan, they only have to be as smart as goats for that big brain. okay, so that's a sort of a quick summary of thinking about climate, and I think a slightly different way. The most extreme climates that hominins can have experienced in the last 4 million years is walking from this riparian forest to just out here in the open grassland. That's the most extreme climates that humans actually had to adapt to and must have adapted to. In closing, in the spirit of this meeting, I saw a sign. I collect African signs because I love the way I love to support local artists and painters, and I found this sign that illustrates human evolution. I don't know whether it's responding to climate, but here you can find the Origins Cafe in the city of Archer's Post. Here's crawling out of the water something and evolving into the pinnacle of evolution, the Samburu warrior. So with that, thanks. That's, I think, there's a different way to think about hominins and climate and the landscape. And of course, how those temperature extremes will affect things like the seeding and that sort of thing that the C3 versus C4 plant competition has. Thank you.
Okay, 3 for 3. So we have some questions for Terry. Bob.
Is it possible that there's a secondary diagenesis that preferentially gets rid of C3 plants and therefore biases your results? I mean, this would be, when they're stored for millions of years, things haven't stopped, something's going on.
You mean in terms of the paleosols for reconstructing?
Yeah.
I don't think so. The paleosols are recording soils, the isotope composition of soil CO2 that's present when the system is active.
Yeah, I forgot that. Excuse me. Bad question.
Yeah.
Eric?
Sarah?
Mike?
Somebody?
Yeah.
Oh.
Gene, you want to ask?
Yes, they are biased to places where deposition takes place, and I mean it's an important point. But also, all of the hominid and hominin fossils also are found only where deposition takes place. So we can only be looking at places where deposition has taken place and now are exposed to erosion. So yes, we don't see that. And we're looking only at places where we have hominin fossils. And so environments that are really high rainfall, we would not get soil carbonate preservation. But we would see other evidences of what kind of soils those would be. We should find laterites and sort of those sort of things. We don't find fossil hominins in East Africa with soils that look like laterites, for instance. So yes, there's a bias, but it's biased toward, we're working with all the, you know, everything that's preserved in the hominin sites.
Hey, Terry. As a follow-up to that question in some way, I was wondering what your ideas about the time scale with which these soil organic matter pools or carbonates are forming over, if you're getting an artificially high woody grassland, wooded bushland kind of signal because you have woodlands and grasslands that are forming in a 50-50 ratio kind of thing, as an extreme example.
Well, the plants are moving around on the landscape at timescales longer than the carbonate formation. So if we quench a soil and dump a bunch of stuff on top of it, and then start with a brand new time zero soil, how long will it take before we begin to get carbonate accumulation? It's different in different places, but it's hundreds of years before you can begin to measure calcium carbonate formation. Before there's enough to be large enough for the nodules, that the sort of things that we collect and work with, my sense is it's sort of time average over a couple of thousand years. So it's whatever that patch of land has had, has seen in that thousand or so or less time frame. But it's much longer than the lifetime of the individual plants growing on the landscape or any of those snapshots that I showed you.
Yeah, I was going to say before that it was would be a great honor to follow Wally in anything here, but the lack of a microphone set me off a little bit. You mentioned again your finding that the Ardipithecus sites are at the far right end of the very open areas, which is very different from what the Ardipithecus team has said. Have you guys simply decided to agree to disagree, or has there been any interaction with Gidey and others in terms of what this might be?
Yes, we had quite a large interaction in Addis last August, where before I could present my paper, I had three papers. But my comment to them is, well, you know, show me where the physics is wrong. Show me where the literature is wrong in this interpretation. So in their basic, the bottom line is, the way I would interpret their paper is, we analyze soil carbonate, therefore it's a forest, not we analyzed soil carbonate and therefore based on the literature it's a forest. It was just sort of, we did this and therefore it supports, we made this measurement that people want us to make and therefore our interpretation is correct. So yeah, we've had some interaction
Do their numbers actually differ from yours?
No.
They have the same numbers with a completely different interpretation.
Those are their numbers.
Okay, that's what I figured.
Right. So those are their numbers. And so that's what I ask is if how do you explain the fact that your values are more positive than any other site older than a million years? And their response was, well, it's a forest. Well, then everything else must be a forest. So, yeah. So,
okay, have a question.
Yeah.
Your ability to distinguish between C3 and C4 depends on the isotopic separation between the two.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering, what's the likelihood, or is there a mechanism by which those N members could drift or shift through time?
There certainly is a mechanism by which the N members could shift or drift with time, and we're actually seeing that right now because we're putting CO2 in the atmosphere, and so both values are moving together as we change the isotope composition of the atmosphere, and that we can document by looking at museum specimens and things in herbaria, and that's been done in a variety of ways. So what we have done is corrected all of our samples back to 1750.
sort of pre-industrial and said, okay, we'll consider that our modern collections have to be interpreted in that context that we think. And then if you go back further in the geological record, we can see, well, there are these some small shifts in the delta C13 of what appears in the global ocean, one of which, by the way, is about 7 million years ago, that's compatible with the change in the total C4 biomass, but it's just a tiny shift. More significantly is exactly where would you be in each of those histograms that have a non-zero width, and you know, we don't know exactly where we are, and so I would say that any time you're doing these interpretations, you don't make your interpretations to decimal places of percent C4 contributions.
So I'll have a question, then Rowan can ask one. So one of the things that you touched on was this idea of a bias in terms of when they're formed. And so my question is whether the absence of pedogenic carbonates in true forested environments, or whether the less representation of them is acting as it's sort of invalidating the normal distribution assumption in this. So you're getting a clipping on the left-hand side of your diagram.
It's possible what we we don't find evidence of, certainly like I was saying, lateritic soils. When we find soils, most of the soils have pedogenic carbonates. So, you know, and I don't, maybe Naomi could give a better fraction of what she thinks that is, but I'd say that most of the time when we find things, yes, this is definitely a soil, it's been long enough to have good soil features develop, it has soil carbonate.
Coming back to the end member business, in the C3 vegetation, due to water use efficiency shifts, you can move in an individual plant substantially along that axis, like from minus 28 to say minus 24 per mil. The C4s also can shift slightly due to whether they're growing in the shade. That can push them up a per mil or two. Do your models correct for these, or through your empirical measurements, have you found that there's no consistent signal to worry about, say, water use efficiency effects brought on by aridification?
On our collections of modern plants,
yeah,
from East Africa, yes, we see those effects. It turns out that as you get to more xeric environments, more drier environments, the C3 plants tend to get more positive, and the C4 plants tend to get more negative. So the mixing line collapses, as it were. As you get to more mesic environments, it broadens. We've included it in our considerations of probability distributions, We have not said, okay, we're going to assume that our mixing line is a xeric mixing line or a mesic mixing lines, for which we would need other evidence to do that.
So the woody cover approach assumes that the open is C4 dominated, right?
Yeah. C4 dominated, but that there can be C3 forbs and herbs if it's open.
So we can apply it over a time range where we think C4 is the dominant thing in open environments, but at what point do you start worrying about it? I mean, at some point it has to matter in the Miocene, it has to matter.
Well, it certainly has to matter in the mid-Miocene, yes. And I frankly don't know, and it's one of the things that I want to talk to Rowan about is, you know, what the, you know, see, you know, how long has the planet seen 200 ppm CO2? And the C4 biomass has gone from being, at 10 million years ago, it was probably less than 5% of net primary productivity in the tropics. Now it's more than 50% in the tropics. It's 23% globally, so probably 50% in the tropics. So in 10 million years, it's basically, it took over the tropics, and the C4 ecosystems at 6 million years ago must have been really different than the ones that we're seeing today. But as you know, I've just been discussing with you, there's virtually no fossil evidence of C4 plants. There's two. You know, there's two plants that are definite C4 plants in the fossil record. Do you know of more, Rowan?
I thought there were three.
Okay. But I mean, the point is there's this incredible isotope signal and there's basically no fossil record. If we, you know, and we've looked for those plants and we've found three out of the how many hundred thousand, probably a couple hundred thousand, you know, plant fossils have been analyzed for isotopes. We found three that are definite C4s. I was aware of two.
And they carry plant carbon, and that's been measured.
Right, but we don't have an individual plant. I mean, I say where we have an individual plant, fossil plant, that we can analyze and say, yes, we know that this plant from the fossil record, this one plant, not a collection of things from many, many plants.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah. But there are.
One individual. Fossil. You can say this plant fossil that I want to put in the Smithsonian and say this is a fossil C4 plant.
Right, can't do that.
Can't do that.
Right, but there are plant derived fossils plant, yes. As fossil molecules.
And we find evidence in teeth, and we find lots and lots of evidence that are actual C4 plants.
Thank you. I'm Ben Passy and. So I'm representing a team of collaborators, John Eiler at Caltech, who his lab essentially invented this clumped isotope thermometry method, and Naomi Levin, Terry Serling, and Frank Brown, who at the time of the study were all at Utah and were driving the field component of the study. So essentially trying to get at, can we get a direct record of temperature environments of human evolution. Okay, so what do we have today? Turkana Basin, mean annual temperature of about 29 degrees Celsius and very little rainfall. And just to contrast with our nearby environments, so Central Park, mean annual temperature of about 13 degrees Celsius. And actually the hottest month of the year, the average high temperature, so when you're sweating and dying in New York City in the middle of July, as hot as it gets during the day is the yearly average temperature in Turkana. Okay, so pretty hot. How does this compare with temperatures globally? So this is a histogram of mean annual temperatures from acclimatology, so each little box is going to be a little grid cell covering the Earth. So 29 degrees Celsius puts you here in the 99th percentile of hottest places on Earth in terms of mean annual temperature. So in a way, it's kind of ironic that Turkana Basin, where we're getting some substantial fraction of our knowledge of human evolution, is such an extreme environment. So was it like that in the past? And we've seen some of this already. We have quite a good handle on, or we're getting a better handle on, the open versus closed question. And I would say that would be, you know, if God came down and said, I'll grant you one piece of information about past climates, then you know, I think I would choose open or closed in terms of relevance to human evolution. But then temperature might be the close second. Okay, so based on this kind of ecometric approach, you can see, looking at the fossil mammals, that through time in the Turkana or in the Omo Basin, you have a decrease in kind of the closed woodland forms. We get kind of that same impression from the paleobotany. So Bonfils says that, so we've got a great variety of ecosystems, more humid conditions, perhaps before about 3.2 million years in East Africa, but cooler and drier conditions later on. And then in the soil carbonates, which Turi just talked about, we see, so this is a record at Gona in Ethiopia from 4 to 0, and parallel record in Turkana, you have this shift C3 to C4 and showing kind of opening of ecosystems. But in terms of temperature, and you got to watch the advisors because they tend to steal slides from your earlier talks. So in a C3, C4 perspective, Nakuru might look very similar to Turkana, okay? But temperature is very different. So Nakuru is a kind of place where you got to keep a warm jacket handy, and Turkana is a kind of place where clothing seems to be optional except for the risk of bad sunburn. Okay, so you can kind of start to try to get at this with things like climate models, and here's an example from the not too distant past. So this would be delta temperature compared to the present day. Warmer in the past would be these kind of brownish colors. And East Africa is kind of at this inconvenient nexus of a lot of sort of variability. It's going to be hard from this kind of climate modeling. Maybe with regional climate models, you can get a little bit closer. And then we've got oxygen isotopes, which has been the traditional geochemical method of getting at past temperature. And it's been incredibly successful in the marine realm, and it frames, so this is a record spanning the entire Cenozoic. It's, you know, oxygen isotopes arguably give us the framework or the backbone of which we think about the long-term climate evolution of Earth. And so this is giving us this idea that we now live in a fairly cool time period compared to the preceding several tens of millions of years, and it's actually a variable time period. So if we zoomed in here, we would see that there's real structure, and especially starting the latest Pliocene and Pleistocene, we're kicking into this very variable climate that's switching back from glacial to interglacial modes. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about clumped isotopes, but I think it'll be convenient to set it up by first reminding ourselves what oxygen isotopes are based on or how essentially it works. So I could draw a chemical equilibrium between water and calcium carbonate, the shell or the soil carbonate, and it's trivial or it's a non-reaction without isotopes, but you can make the left and right-hand sides unique if you throw in isotopes. So this would now be an isotope exchange reaction where we're swapping O18 between water and calcium carbonate. And so you could draw an equilibrium constant to this kind of reaction where it's just the concentration of things on the right-hand side divided by the concentration of species on the left-hand side. Okay. And we can reduce this to simply the oxygen isotope ratio of the calcium carbonate divided by the oxygen isotope ratio of the water. And then thermodynamics tells us that these equilibrium constants are related to temperature. So this ratio, or the partitioning of oxygen between water and calcium carbonate, should be temperature dependent. And indeed it is. And it's not very temperature dependent, so this value is a number very close to one. But the heavy isotope likes to be in the condensed phase, and so this equilibrium leans to the right on the order of about 30 parts per thousand. Okay, so that gives us the basis of the oxygen isotope thermometer. In the marine realm, okay, so in order to constrain this K, which is giving you temperature, you need to know both the delta O18 of the water and that of the calcium carbonate. Of course, for the paleo stuff, we have the shell, as it were, but we don't have the water. In the marine realm, you can get pretty far by making assumptions about what the composition of the water was. So the oceans are not going to vary widely. Okay. When you get to the terrestrial realm, this water is now coming from rainfall, which has a huge amount of oxygen isotope variation compared to marine water. So essentially, the oxygen isotope thermometer doesn't work in terrestrial realms. And when you see delta O18 measurements of carbonates, it's usually that a temperature is assumed, like mean annual temperature, and they're using it to get back at the delta O18 of the water. Okay, so clumped isotopes, we start out with, we want an equation where we're getting rid of the water. Okay, so we have calcium carbonate doing nothing. Okay, so we can make it unique by, now we have to throw in both carbon and oxygen isotopes. And we have to consider the clumped species. So this is a single molecule that has two rare isotopes in it. So we start out with two molecules, each with one rare isotope, and we make a molecule with no rare isotope and one with a double substitution. So we could draw up a similar equilibrium constant. And then we have to ask, is this thing, because so thermodynamics, or the heavy isotope likes to be in the molecule with the heavy isotope is favored. So you got a bit of a possible conundrum where here on this side, you've got two molecules, each with a single substitution. Here you've got this golden child, the double substitution, but it's coming along with the one that doesn't have any substitutions. So is this thing going to lean to the left or the right? Or is it going to largely cancel out? And it turns out that it leans to the right, and with oxygen isotopes, that preference is about 30 parts per thousand. For this clumped isotope, the preference is more on the order of one part per thousand. Okay, and but it's temperature dependent. Okay, so we can just redraw the same equilibria, and what we're actually measuring in the mass spectrometer is carbon dioxide that's generated from the carbonate by reacting it in acid. So on the mass spectrometer, we're measuring these masses, and so the mass 47 carbon dioxide is a C13, O18, O16. And so then this delta 47, which is what we're measuring as it's our measure of the enrichment in this clumped species, is the ratio of mass 47 CO2 normalized to the common isotope log 44, divided by the ratio that you would get if there was no thermodynamic or temperature-dependent preference for the clumped. Okay, so we calculate this ratio based on our measurements of the ratios of carbon-13 to carbon-12 and oxygen-18 to oxygen-16. So the temperature is coming in the enrichment of this clumped species. Okay. So does it actually work? Sounds good. So this is probably small and fuzzy from where you're sitting. This is the sort of empirical calibration. So this is delta 47 versus 1 over T squared down here and temperature here. So this is 0 up to 40. And we have a bunch of things, mostly biogenics, foraminifera, corals, mollusks, brachiopods, etc. And for an isotope method, this is reasonably good. So yes, there is some scatter, but there's a clear temperature signal. We are, as time has moved on and different laboratories are getting into the game, we're seeing that there's some calibrations with slightly different slopes, and we're trying to figure out exactly what's going on, if it's methodological or lack of a good reference frame until just this past year with the publication of a new paper recommending a new reference frame, but it's looking pretty good. Okay, but the signal is very small, so the total range in this delta 47 from 0 to 50 degrees C is 0.2 per mil, whereas we saw with carbon isotopes in plants, if we're talking about the C3 to C4 N member, you've got 15 per mil to play with, and the analytical precision for delta C13 is 0.1 or less. And for delta O18, you've also got a big range. Okay, so to be in the game of doing meaningful thermometry, then you've got to have a very high precision measurement on an analyte that's very rare. So it's a challenging measurement, but it's doable. Okay, and so the analytical precision is approaching 2 degrees C if you measure samples sort of in triplicate or more using the kind of standard methods that different labs use. And so we can kind of compare the difficulty factor of clumped isotopes versus normal isotopes. So since the mass 47 signal is very small on the mass spectrometer, you've got to integrate that ion beam for very long periods of time to get the precision down. So you've got a slow rate of analysis. We're also doing a huge amount of bracketing unknowns with standards. So a good day is about 5 new unknowns, but if you're analyzing everything in triplicate, then that's really 1 2/3 new samples. And it takes a lot of material. And anyway, it's a new method, and it's getting more efficient and whatnot, but it's still kind of a slow, laborious process. Okay, so the question is, can we apply this to soil carbonates? And just as a brief reminder, soil carbonate is calcium carbonate, most commonly calcite mineral that forms in situ in the soil. And so you need some source of calcium ion, which in the volcanic derived soils of the Turkana Basin is readily available. The CO2 in a productive soil is coming primarily from plant respiration, and that's why carbon isotopes of plants are recorded in soil carbonates. And then you've got to have water that dissolves everything, and then when the soils dry out, you can have supersaturation with respect to calcium carbonate. And supersaturation is also partially driven by decreasing CO2 concentrations as the soil dries and the plants become less productive. Okay, and so carbonates in these kind of nodular forms, or you might get pendants. And getting back to this bias thing, so yes, carbonates only form in the drier end of the climate spectrum and typically in seasonal climates, but within this kind of category, you've still got quite a bit of potential variation in climate. Okay, so the idea, we have this new method. Let's try it out, Turkana. So we've got Frank Brown and Turi Serling and Naomi Levin, who combined have spent many, many decades in the Turkana Basin working out the geochronology and the geology, etc. And so the idea is to kind of put together 4 million year record of, you know, we could do probably 20 or 30 unique horizons of paleosols. We've got the field team, and we've got the lab teams, and John Eiler directing the clumped isotope group at Caltech, and I did a lot of this work while I was a postdoc at Caltech and playing around with these kind of gizmos. And so I'll just cut to the chase and show you the results of the study. So here it is. So 4 million years to the present, delta 47 in the soil carbonate, and the equivalent temperature. And so this is where we're getting these, so the mean annual temperature is here at 29, and we're getting these incredibly high temperatures, or what seemed to be incredibly high at the time. And at the time that this data were generated, there were, let's say, 60 measurements existing in the world of paleosol carbonates from anywhere, paleosol, and maybe 5 to 10 measurements of recent soil carbonates. So we're kind of putting the cart before the horse and working on the paleo stuff before we properly worked out the systematics in recent soils. So does this delta 47 clumped isotope thermometer actually work in soil carbonates? And if it does, if it works, how does it work? So we've seen a bit of this. So what temperatures should, or what's controlling the temperature in the soil? And whoops. Okay, so we can have a temperature envelope in the soil, which would be driven on the first order by the annual range in air temperature. But then we have to realize that it's actually not air temperature that's the relevant boundary condition, but it's the surface skin temperature of the soil. And that's going to be related to air temperature and solar heating and latent heat issues. And so what does it actually look like? So this is, you know, we've all walked barefoot on black asphalt on a hot day, so we know that the surface can get very hot. These are fields that are planted versus not planted during a hot summer day. So the surface temperature, as Turi showed, can get very hot. And Fortunately, soon after we generated this data, Turi and Naomi and others were headed to Turkana, and at the last minute, they kind of got these hobo temperature loggers that they could take with them and bury in the soil at different depths to see what the actual soil temperatures are in this environment. And so they left them there for about 9 months, and so the black line is showing the 50 centimeter depth soil temperature, and the aqua is 25, and air temperature in the shade is gray. So we can see that the soils really are in this kind of 30 to 40 degree range in temperature. You get depression of soil temperatures when it rains. So, and more of these kinds of measurements where the loggers were placed in, under open grassland soils and bush environments and forest, and you see this clear influence of solar heating. And I discovered this book, which is just full, it's kind of encyclopedic of all these studies where, okay, what's the temperature inside of a white car on a hot day versus a black car, and all of these things where people are studying the near surface thermal environment. It's an interesting book. Okay, and I'll just whip through this. Then we did what we were supposed to do and got around to actually measuring modern soil carbonates in climates that we have some idea of the temperature range. And we're generally, the carbonates are in a seasonal climate, they're biased towards the warm season aspect. And this would be the range of temperatures from these same temperature loggers that we buried in a soil in the Mojave Desert in California. And so if you look at the clumped isotope temperature versus mean annual temperature, you get something that's not too pleasing. And so the black would be low latitude or high latitude soils, and red is low latitudes. But if you plot things versus mean warm season temperature, then you get something that's looking a little better. Okay, so the suggestion is that carbonates in temperate environments are biased towards forming in the warm season. In the tropics, it doesn't really matter because there's very little seasonality. Temperature. Okay, so in this context, present soil temperature is here, and so these paleo temperatures actually seem plausible, and on average, they're a little bit cooler than the present day soil temperature that we measured over that 9 month interval, but they're not very different. Okay, a couple of late breaking updates in terms of new data. So Seth Finnegan, who's a postdoc at Caltech, along with Turi, who's visiting Caltech the semester sabbatical, and John Eiler, have been measuring clumped isotopes and stromatolites. So these are going to give you lake temperature. And the present day lake temperature is about 30 degrees Celsius. And so they've got a couple of ages, what, 1.6 and something like 0.7. And the temperatures are sort of between 25 and 30. So they're perhaps a little cooler on average than the present lake. And then they've got some Holocene stuff, so you know, a few thousand years old, and they're getting about 30 degrees C for the Holocene. Okay. And the other new thing is that Zalalem Badasso, working with Naomi Levin and myself, Johns Hopkins, has put together a soil carbonate clumped isotope record from Gona in Ethiopia, and we haven't really assembled it in terms of the age record, but the temperatures are coming out between 30 and 40 degrees Celsius. We're getting this similar kinds of things. Okay, so I think this gives us some broad constraints on climate. You know, so we could say, is the air temperature in the past warmer than present or cooler? And was there less shade or more shade? So if air temperature was warmer and there was less shade, then we'd expect the soils to be significantly warmer than present. And if air was cooler and there was more shade, then the soil should be significantly cooler. And I argue that the soil temperatures are pretty much the same as what we're getting today. And so it gives us some kind of axis of possible environments, but it's probably hard to get too much less shade than you have in Turkana today, so maybe we're, you know, somewhere in here. Okay, but putting it back into this perspective certainly was not Nakuru National Park. So, terms of implications, and this is where I could get into a lot of trouble, and so I'll just kind of cruise through this thing, but humans do have some very remarkable and unique characteristics. We're virtually naked. We have a copious capacity for copious sweating. We're bipedal and fairly slender. And so one idea is if you're quadrupedal, you're close to the ground. And so this is some of the work of Peter Wheeler in the early 90s. So this is a graph of the surface area distribution of a quadrupedal animal as a function of distance above the ground versus a biped. And if you're in an open equatorial environment, the ground is going to be much hotter than the air, and so you'll have some kind of temperature profile. And so if you're close to the ground, you're actually in the warmer air. And if there's a vegetation canopy, then this is creating a kind of boundary layer of, or kind of thickening the zone of warming. And so Wheeler went through, I don't know much about this stuff, but reading these papers seemed like a pretty reasonable and sophisticated calculations using real physics. And considering the influence of hair loss or a slender stature or bipedal locomotion or even body size, and comes up with, you know, small, significant, not huge, but real thermoregulatory advantages to being bipedal and slender versus being quadrupedal. But those calculations presuppose hot, open conditions. And so, in a sense, we have a record that says that those hot, open conditions actually existed, and so perhaps it's, you know, we can think more about those kinds of hypotheses. Okay, so the final thing and the question, and perhaps this is something for future research, is, and we got into this in Turi's talk, when do the soil carbonates actually form? And so this is eccentricity. Do they form during some aspect of the eccentricity cycle or the insulation cycle? And despite the fact that the Turkana Basin is one of the best dated terrestrial sections in the world, thanks to Frank Brown and Ian McDougall and colleagues, we still can't pin down the ages of these paleosols well enough to know exactly where they formed. And did hominids inhabit these environments precisely during the times that carbonates formed? So one simple approach is what fraction of the paleosols actually have soil carbonates. And so it's the kind of notion of people that have worked there that most of them have carbonates, but this could be a very interesting study of just going through very systematically, maybe incorporating GIS and whatnot so you can kind of quantify things and what fraction of soils actually have soil carbonates. Are there soils that don't, that could be the forest environment that's sort of missing from the carbonate isotopic record? So I will conclude with that, and thanks especially to the Dreyfus Foundation and the National Science Foundation grants to John Eiler that supported my postdoc work, and various people who helped out on the technical aspects and read early versions of the manuscript that we ultimately submitted to describe this work. So thank you.
Well, a spectacular data set. So Renee has a question. Yair has a question.
Oops. Yeah, I see.
You've got the microphone
here. I assume you have Deloitte of the carbonates. Did you try to calculate what was the Deloitte of the water?
We did, and I foolishly deleted that slide from the presentation. But yeah, so we've got that, and essentially it's close to zero per mil through from about 4 to, 1.5, and then it ramps up, and you get values as high as +5, +6 per mil, the latter half of the record.
And what do you learn from that about the precipitation and the changes at that time?
It's a good question. And so those really enriched numbers are interesting because, you know, so Turkana, Lake Turkana can be evaporatively enriched, but these are soils that are presumably forming in meteoric waters. the same time, you have the Ethiopian highlands, which today have this anomalously high delta O18 of precipitation. And actually, Naomi's worked on trying to explain why that is. And so one possibility is that, that those high values are just reflecting some strange circulation where you get incredibly high meteoric water values. But I'm not sure what the significance paleoenvironmentally is.
Yeah, very nice talk. One of the persistent features that we're showing in these talks is that in many of these landscapes, we have these major river systems, and typically with the riverine forest, and then these more open floodplains and so on. And the data that you're showing may come perhaps more from the more open parts of the landscape. Likewise, the carbon isotopes that Tori Serling was talking about. And one of the things that I'm thinking about is that many of the fossils that we get in places like the Turkana Basin are associated with deltaic sands, and they seem to be coming from some of the areas that are much closer to the what we would call the axial parts of the rivers. And to the extent that you just made the point that you have the hot temperatures and then thinking about hominid and other mammal adaptations, we may have a discrepancy in terms of where the fossils are coming from within these landscapes and where some of these other indications of environments, temperatures, vegetation may be coming from. Just wanted to point that out and ask for your comments about that.
Yeah, I mean, well, I know very little about the geology of this area, but yeah, from my limited perspective, I think that is a frontier, is kind of reconciling those sorts of questions. You know, how biased is it, and can we quantify these things somehow?
Yeah, Ben, as a follow-up to that, I think it's important to also emphasize that the soils are forming during times of cessation of deposition, in a sense, that they're the stable places where the plants can have enough time to put down roots and to do their thing. Are we close to having any kind of a temperature indicator of the parent material? That is the time of the depositional periods when things do get buried, and are the times prior to soil formation. Is there any kind of method of being able to do that? So, for example, as I understand it, some of these soils are formed on parent material, which may be about a half a meter or something like that. That's maybe a considerable amount of time it takes to deposit that, or it may be very, very quick. But nonetheless, these are important intervals in addition to the ones we cannot see, like the erosional periods. But at least for the depositional ones, is there any kind of thing maybe from diatoms, which can be sometimes parent material for soils or other kinds of clay, is anything with clay minerals, whereby we could also get a temperature indicator for the times in between the soil formation periods?
Yeah, possibly. I guess you'd have to have something that you were very confident formed in that parent material after it had been deposited and not as the original source sediment in the highlands or something. And so, yeah, maybe, yeah. Maybe more of vadose zone carbonates could be forming, or that's a good in situ clay formation. But those on some level are also going to be linked with the soil development. So
our last speaker is Naomi Levin, and Naomi was actually part of this group out on the veranda talking about this meeting that we ought to have, and so she's partly responsible for us all being here today.
I get the benefit of sort of playing sweep in a way. But actually, to answer Rick's question, because I think a lot of these, part of my talk is going to try to reconcile all these proxies, because I love complexity and I love throwing it all in the pot and I believe in finding order in it. The thing about paleosols is, sure, they're not depositional, but man, there is always a surface somewhere, right? So those hominids, if they weren't walking on that paleosol, they were walking on another paleosol. So I think we have so many paleosols throughout this record in the Turkana Basin and the Awash Basin, and I would be shocked if the hominids left when the soils were forming, right? So these soils are, even though they're not depositional, I think they're an omnipresent aspect of the landscape, and how representative they are is a really good question and something that we can start to tackle. So I've been charged with teeth. solar carbonates have been taken away from me in the Stirling Passy Levin back-to-back talks. But part of that is, you know, thinking about mosaics and thinking about variability and thinking about reconciling records. Okay, so I did try to not just recycle some talks, but actually think about these sorts of questions. So this premise of this meeting is, did climate change shape human evolution? And if so, how do we recognize it? How do we get there? Okay, so this is how I see the basic questions, and you might see that one and two are the same, but I don't think so. So how did climate change in the places and during the time intervals relevant to human evolution? Okay, that's a big picture. What is the climate state of the Earth at this time? Okay, what is the climate state of East Africa at this time? The second question is, how is climate change expressed in the environments where human evolution occurred? And then a slight variant of that, but an important difference, is in the environments where the evidence for human evolution is preserved, okay? So that's a really significant thing that we have to sort of distinguish, and these are actually different questions, okay? And this actually gets to the kinds of records that we can generate, whether we're looking at a marine core, or we're looking in a lake, or a soil, a paleosol. And then this other question, which is really important to answering, to connecting these two parts of this question, is what are the links between climate change, terrestrial environmental change, and human evolution? Okay, so my premise for this is, to address these questions, we must understand the setting for human evolution. We need to understand the geography, we need to understand the vegetation, and then the climates of the places where these early humans lived as much as we possibly can. Okay. So this is not a representative group of people who I've worked with, but this work and the work going forward, and I really think that the way that we're going to address these questions is having field geologists and geochronologists and geochemists and isotope ecologists and paleontologists and paleoanthropologists and archaeologists working together. Okay, and so all of this work that I'm going to present is actually, this is work that I really think that Turi and Frank and John and Meve started a long time ago, and I'm just, you know, hopping in the boat midstream of it. But it's a real culmination of an effort, and I feel like in order to make the progress going forward, we need to continue to find good colleagues and work with them and talk to them and then also listen to them too, okay? All right, so here we are, and I take this as inspiration for when we think about how this continent has responded to the climate changes over the timescale of human evolution, whatever that timescale is and how that's important to you, whether it's the last 2 million years, the last 40,000 years, or the last 8 million years. And the thing that is notable to me about this place is how variable it is when we look at it, okay? It's full of very many different types of landscapes. We see a very tiny sliver and slice of it in the record of human evolution that's remarkable, but we really are focused on these rift basins. So the premise of how I sort of approach these kinds of questions, and you can evaluate whether you think that they're they're valid or not, but I think that the story of human evolution is really archived in rift basins. And whether you like it or not, whether it's representative, it's what we have. It's what we have to work with, and we might as well do as much as we possibly can to squeeze as much information out of that. And those rift basins are, by their nature, heterogeneous. They're heterogeneous environments, okay? And they are complex. But we basically cannot shy away from their complexity if we really want to understand them. So my premise is that we have to expect messiness, we have to expect mosaics, and recognizing the climate change trends amidst this kind of variation is our challenge, all right? It's not going to be, you know, we're going to push the climate system this way and the terrestrial system is going to react that way, right? So we have to sort of embrace it all and make sense of it and move forward in a sort of a cogent way. So I'm going to zoom in and focus on sort of two aspects, and I'm going to go back and forth between the past and the present, because that's how I think, and that's how I think we actually all need to sort of move forward in this system. But the past and the record is, I've worked a lot in the Afar Basin and then also in Turkana. And this is where the human evolution record is. But then we also sort of extend, I guess Turkana's down here. I'm having trouble perceiving it here. The lake is green. But then we also have a tremendous archive and record that we can use of the modern system as analogs. Okay, so this is all of our playground and all of our opportunity of what we can use to sort of try to understand this sliver of a perspective that we have in these two basins. the focus is on these two basins because this is where I've happened to work extensively, but I think that we also really need to, but there's also other records, but they actually also happen to be primarily limited in some ways to the rift itself. Okay, people have talked about the soil carbonate records, and I will just briefly mention them, but just for the point is that we actually can, as an example, if we have evidence for heterogeneity on multiple scales, and I think we have that, we can embrace it, and we have to, the soil carbonates represent a way that we need to move forward with it. So we've got these beautiful soils in the Awash and Turkana. You know, I've seen this variance of this slide in many ways, but we have two different basins, relatively coeval unit records through time. Both show a shift towards increase in C4 vegetation and openness. However, they actually are quite different in terms of if you look at the absolute scales of when that happens, okay? So these systems are, if you think of toolmakers on the shores of the Omo River coming out of the northern part of the Turkana Basin, or toolmakers on the shore of the Awash River, they might have actually had very different vegetation regimes, or maybe slightly different vegetation regimes that they were sitting amongst, okay? And that's something that, these are the kinds of questions, we've now done this work, and now the question is, all right, I need to talk to my archaeology colleagues and saying, is there anything significant in that, right? Can we delve into that further? And is there something there? Is that meaningful, right? Is this what we want, right? Are there differences? Are they the same? So I think this sort of scales that we can get at. If we zoom in on the Turkana Basin, this has already been mentioned, but within a basin scale, the axial system is in more C3, looks more closed than the downstream part of the system. You guys have seen that now. And if we kind of even delve further onto a landscape scale, onto the floodplain, and if we go to the Awash system, the Busidima formation, where we have evidence for a really nice through-flow river, this is right where the evidence of the first stone tools are, and we sample on a much smaller scale, and this might be getting to some of the questions that some of you guys have been asking about time period and can we record a C3 system. And we sample next to a channel conglomerate, which had been laid down by a river like this, and we sample what I think would be across the paleo floodplain. We see a huge change in delta 13C values from negative 8 per mil all the way up to negative 2 per mil. Okay? This negative 8 per mil, if that soil carbonate window is open for 1,000 years, maybe at one point there was an input that was down here, right? But that input, that riverine pure C3 system, wasn't inputting its CO2 for long enough to that soil carbonate to get that pure C3 signal recorded. That's one reason why we don't see the full spectrum. But if you put this full spectrum, this basically 6 per mil spectrum, into the context of the big story, well, that's most of our record right here, okay? And we shouldn't shy away from that. That's okay, right? There's actually information in that, and we can understand our system better. We can understand where these hominids were on the landscape better if we can actually understand this story in light of this story. Okay, teeth. I think of teeth in many ways, and I know that there's more people who are going to talk about teeth and the aspects of teeth. But teeth and the isotopes of teeth can tell us about the organism, its diet, its physiology, over the formation of that tooth, okay? Not necessarily the formation of the animal's lifetime. But it tells us what the animal's doing, how it's responding to climate change, were they doing the same thing in different places. Groups of teeth, so groups of data. Is my mic on if I'm away from it? Sure. Okay. Groups of data provide sort of perspective on how these animals are interacting with each other through ecological relationship. And then multiple teeth from an assemblage can also tell us about that environment itself. So they're sort of, in a way, teeth are biological recorders. We can take advantage of the different biology of different animals to actually get information out of the whole scale environment. So what I want you to take away from this is that the isotopic value of teeth provide us quantitative environmental information that's pretty much independent of morphology, and it's comparable among fossil sites separated by space and time. Okay. In contrast to soil carbonates, which are restricted to floodplain environments, these are records of floodplain environments, stable surfaces, and that are integrative, fossil teeth have they tell us about diet and habitat preference. They integrate over short time intervals. They're representative of a spatial range of that animal. So that animal might die in the floodplain, but it might be living, it might be spending a lot of its time outside of that floodplain. So we can sample the extra floodplain environment with these animals. We can use multiple taxon approaches, which I'll give some examples of. And importantly, we can generate these records from the places where we have the hominids themselves, okay? So it's direct, and the nice thing too is that these kinds of data actually can talk to each other in a really nice way, okay? So we can link them together, and when they disagree, we can sort of, or seem to disagree, we can come up with sort of ways to think about this. Okay, this is how I see how you approach a stable isotope study of teeth. You work on monadnot analyte systems, you team up with a paleontologist or an archaeologist or more than them, you work in museums and curators to secure permission, and then you sample the teeth, and then you do them in all sorts of different orders, and you keep doing it, and you keep building these huge data sets. This is a, these are lessons learned from Turi and that followed, and I think they're good general lessons. So how do we do this work? This is important if you're a curator of a collection. Well, one way is to drill it. This is, so we can just make a couple millimeters of a mark on a tooth there. I love broken teeth, diagnostic broken teeth. We can drill them, powder them, bring the powder back to the lab, analyze them on the mass spectrometer. This is a system, a laser ablation system, that Ben and Turi have really pioneered and perfected. But this is for teeth that are small, the precious. You can have greater sampling resolution. This little bar, oh, you can't even see it, but you can trust me, that bar right there is 100 microns across. But anyway, you can have much smaller pit size. The problem with this is the teeth have to leave the country until we can figure out a way to have a steady liquid nitrogen supply and maybe a mass spectrometer in some of these museums, okay? But this is the way we get this data, and this is the way that the data that I'll show will be, that's how it was generated. The first step modern analog studies, this is over lots of years, these are not all the sites that we've worked in, but basically sample, generate carbon and oxygen isotope records from range of mammals, large and small, range of environmental gradients. These are some of the papers where this modern analog data has been published. Okay, so we'll talk about some of these sites. So this is a graph showing relative distribution of C3 and C4 plants in carbon isotope space. Playing my sweep role, everybody's talked to you about this, there is variation in C3 and C4 plants. But basically, you are where you eat, plus 14 per mil, maybe depending upon your physiology, plus 12 per mil. So that's the plus 14 per mil is a good number for bovids and for lots of organisms. The exact amount of that number, I was just talking to Renee Babe last night, is something that we could do further work with, but in terms of the scale of variation we have here, plus 14 per mil is what we're going to be looking at. Okay, so what kind of isotopic gradients can we get? If we track one taxa, this is data from Impala, so Epistoros melampus, I'm probably pronouncing that wrong. This is mean annual precipitation. This is the delta 13C of the enamel itself. This is a more dry environment to a more wet environment. Whoa, wait a second, these things are doing really different things depending upon where they are. And that's in the modern system today, one climate, right? We're in one climate system today, and these animals are responding to based on where they were. So if it's dry, these impala eat more C3 vegetation, okay, in general, right? And if it's more wet, they're eating more C4 plants, okay? This is not, you know, C3 and C4 plants can still exist in both, but man, you know, I'd eat those nice lush grasses too if I could. Otherwise, if I can't get those, then I'm gonna eat the marginal C3 plants here, okay? So this is the first step, is that we can use stable isotopes in teeth to track a gradient, okay? And we gotta use this to our advantage. So there are gonna be some taxa, like impala, that are gonna go whichever the wind blows, right? Go with it, wherever the good food is, okay? Some animals aren't gonna do this, but if we had impala across the landscape 2 million years ago, we could actually maybe use it to have a sense for climate differences and the climate variability at one particular time point. Other examples of what we can do this is new data from rodents. This is work with Chalamanthi and Prince Kaleme and Kevin Uno and Turi. We sampled rodents from all these places. I'll just show you some of the data. But what I want to give you a sense for is how we can use these animals, this is modern data, how we can use these animals to look at differences. So this is Tachyorhynchus, the root rat from Bali Mountains in Ethiopia, and from an owl collection in Nairobi, an owl accumulation down here. And these Tachyorhynchus are doing basically the same thing in carbon isotope space wherever they are. Otomus from the same different collections are also sort of doing very similar things, both highland environments separated by varied distances. If you go to this Priamus, the soft fur rats, and you go to the Kakamega forest right here, and then you go to the Kahuzi Biega area, these swamps in the Congo, first of all, you see that they're doing very different things from these other animals, okay? And also that this Kakamega forest, which is a broadleaf forest, they're actually doing different things in this forest than they're doing in this forest. Okay, so right here, these are micro mammals They're concentrated in small sorts of environments, but they give us insights to where they were. Okay? Some of these animals, and you can extend this example to fossil animals and lots of different organisms, some of them are going to kind of be doing the same thing no matter where they are. Right? Some of them are going to be differentiating greatly based on who they are, right? This versus this, and also where they are, this versus that. Another example comes from gerbils from Kenya, and actually this is different parts of the Turkana Basin. So Kubi 4 and Ilaret are on the east side of the basin, Kanapoi is on the west side of the basin. And you can see that gerbils have this large range in delta 13C values. They're doing lots of different stuff, okay? But even in the same basin, this Kanapoi record actually looks different, okay? And why it is, was it because they were collected from scats in November and not in August? Maybe, okay, but these are the kinds of variability that we may be able to sort of seek out, and as we understand these modern systems better, we can then start to understand how we can maybe use these tools to sort of get at the variability that we know existed in the fossil record as well. So here's an example of the fossil record. This is from a site that I worked at with Dave Braun, an archaeologist, in North Turkana in the Ilaret region, or close to Ilaret, a 1.95 million archaeological site that was actually used for a sort of evidence for omnivory at this time period. Beautiful site, really well constrained. I colored this. This is not orange sediment. But just so this is the actual archaeological horizon. This is where all the teeth come from. We have got a nailed assemblage. This was a very well-preserved assemblage right here. We have the delta 13C and delta 18O values of these teeth. These are all the teeth that we could sample, so from all sorts of bovids, elephants, horses, giraffes, hippos, rhinos, three different kinds of pigs. Everything's doing C4, except for the giraffes. Not a surprise, right? If we zoom in on this time period, what can we do if we've got this assemblage so well organized here? I'll actually speak to the differences between the oxygen isotope space in just a second. But if we zoom in on this, and this is just a plug for really well-provenient samples, we can actually see distinct differences. So these are all the pigs and the elephants here, and they're just a couple per mil lower, but significantly lower than the acelophines and the redunceids, okay? So this question is, are they partitioning out C4 resources ever so slightly? Or is this a physiological question? Is the fractionation factor between these pigs and these bovids slightly different? Are the hippos partitioning out the C4, C3 landscape different? Or are they accessing different kinds of plants that have different delta 13C values? So I don't have these answers yet, right? But what I want to argue for this is that we can zoom in on this detail. The better I work with an archaeologist who can really constrain where those fossils are coming from, the clearer the data can sort of parse out. And if we appreciate the differences between these different animals, we might actually be able to get sort of more information out of this whole landscape. So I'll zoom through because I know everybody's hungry. But my one last thing that I want to talk about is trying to make sense out of this oxygen isotope data. And we all have all this oxygen isotope data, and what does it mean? And so we go to the modern first, and tapping into the big collection of modern teeth that we have from all over East Africa, but really focusing on these regions that are labeled here. And the important thing that I want you to note here is that we've got a range of environments listed here. So mean annual temperature rate ranges from 180 millimeters per year, which is Turkana, what Ben talked about, up to 1,700 millimeters per year, which is the Ituri forest. We wanted to compare these things to relative humidity, but another challenge that we have in these modern analog systems is that Africa is also very poorly monitored. So we didn't have relative humidity data, but we were able to calculate potential evapotranspiration out of the system and then mean annual precipitation into the system. So I'll talk about this water deficit, which is basically the amount of water leaving the system versus the amount of water that's coming into the system. We sampled lots of taxa, but I'm going to talk to you about hippos and giraffes. Giraffes, because I think they're the most exemplary data, and they're sort of the easiest to understand at first, but we were tracking these. Our initial premise was if giraffes are dependent upon leaf water, their delta 18O value is going to track aridity, whereas the hippos, if they're living in, if they're very close to aquatic terrains, which we know that they are, then they're going to be tracking the oxygen isotopic composition of the water that they're living in. So we go around and we are as scrappy as we possibly can be and go to places like Mago and Netchasar to find giraffe teeth and hippo teeth and what we're thinking of water independent and water dependent. We have anyone who's worked with oxygen isotopes know, and Ben pointed this out, that the input of the system, the delta 18 of water, is highly variable terrestrially. So you know, how do I know what this leaf water, the water that the giraffe's getting, what does it mean in terms of climate from place to place if the input water to that leaf can change? So what we can do is we can normalize all of the tooth data that we get to the local water. So this is what this epsilon is, and it basically means the delta 18O of the enamel minus the delta 18O of the water itself. And we do that for hippos as well. So I'll show you a plot. So this is water deficit. So this is very mesic, and this is very xeric, and this is the difference between enamel and water. And if we look at that, this is the Ituri forest, Nairobi, Impala today, Turkana today. So as we go further and further arid areas, the giraffes get more and more and more separated from the local water. Okay, their delta 18O gets more separated. And hippos, they don't care. Okay. Hippos, they're always, you know, 30, 33 per mil enriched of negative of water. They don't change across this huge gradient in environments. So the question is, all right, Naomi, how can you help me for the fossil record? I can't normalize my giraffe teeth to water. So what can I do? Well, we know that hippos don't vary, so just normalize it to a hippo, okay? So I'm just gonna treat hippo like water plus 30 to 33 per mil. And if this should work, right? If giraffe to hippo increases, delta 18O increases, then I should be getting to more xeric environments. So this is our giraffe to hippo comparison in the Ituri forest to Turkana, right? And this is just the same data, just changing the comparisons, okay? So we have the same slope from water deficit to this epsilon value for giraffe to local water from giraffe to hippo, even though the scales are off by around 30 per mil. So let's go to the Turkana Basin, see what we can do. Do we have giraffes and hippos from places? Yes, I would like more, but these are various sites that we have data from for the Turkana Basin, where we can make this comparison, and this is our data. So this is giraffe hippo, so I just put the modern landscapes here. You can see where they fit relatively. This is the Ituri forest. This would be like a rainforest with very little difference between a hippo and a giraffe. This is what Nairobi would be, Sava would be, and this is where Turkana would be today. So if we go through time, what we see is there's sometimes a canopy when it was actually quite arid. This is Alia Bay. This is the Australopithecus anamensis site. It was middling. At the time, the Loma Kui sites near where we were able to get data, the Canyanthropus sites is actually more mesic in the past than it was today. The Black Skull site was more xeric. And these sites really cluster. These are the early archaeological sites on the east side of Lake Turkana. And then this is this FWJJ20 that I showed you that data from before. And these are all collapsed, actually. They're much more mesic. And this is Arty down here. It's quite dry. So these data actually give some insight into these are from the fossil sites themselves. We don't have anything that would support a closed canopy system, right? Everything's a little bit too dry for that. But the important points that we see here is throughout this time period, we see going back and forth, there are different mesic and xeric states in the landscape. And we also don't see any sort of general trend. So if there were these large scale trends, these hominids might have been seeing sort of small scale variations back from xeric and mesic conditions through time. So to sort of finish up, what's next? Where do we go on from here? We need to build more records. We've got these tools. We need to work and sort of extract the information as much as possible. This involves finding new sites. This involves collecting more samples. This involves coming up with good collection strategies where our paleontological colleagues. And provenience is critical. So the better we know where the sample's from, the better the data are. Okay, so we really need to try to integrate the data, the geologic data, the isotopic data, and the paleontological data, even if they don't seem to disagree, if they seem to disagree initially. And this would be my response to the gentleman who asked about the Middle Awash data. The data are there, right? So we just need to, come up with a better way to make sense of them. But we can believe, the nice thing about it is that these isotopic data can be published, and we just need to do a better job of figuring out how it all works. And so I think as we're moving forward and thinking about what do we do next? Well, we really need to sort of consider what we know about the terrestrial systems and what we know about climate change, and then sort of come up with, well, how is this system going to respond to this climate forcing that we think we're putting on it? And do we see with that expectation? So we have to like appreciate this complexity of the system, and then also continue to build these new toolkits to study modern analogs. Okay, thanks.
Okay, we have time for just a couple of questions, and then we have lunch. grumbling stomachs.
So your data suggested that it looks a little wetter today than it was millions of years ago. And the last talk we heard, it was a little hotter than it
Wait,
is today.
Wetter today?
Wasn't it a little wetter in the last?
So this is?
The climate, is it not wetter? Am I misreading that?
High water deficit, arid. So this is more arid. So this is Turkana today. This was Turkana 1.8 million years ago. So it was a little bit wetter 1.8 million years ago.
Yeah, so it's a little less arid and a little wetter. But the last talk, the temperature was a little higher. So how do you reconcile those? So it was hotter, but more humid?
So on average, the mean annual temperature from the soil temperatures from Ben Passy's results was actually several degrees lower in the fossil record than they are today. So you could argue a couple degrees more cooler. But this is a good question, and we have to this temperature data has thrown us for a loop. We asked for it, right? Wouldn't it be great to know temperature? And now we know what do we do with it? How do we integrate it? And that's a great question. How do we make hot environments in C4 systems? How do we get the same temperatures from the Shingura C3 system and a more open system downstream? So now that we're generating these records, we're forced to instead of thinking, oh, open, close, end of story, it's no. There's some more complexity here, and I think that it's a challenge to us to understand it. But the data are good. It's just we're limited in terms of our models right now. But stay tuned.
One last question from Eric.
This is more a little bit of a comment. This was wonderful presentations, in fact, all of them today that I heard. But you started off by saying all of our information is from rift valleys. But in fact, that's East African information.
Sure.
And there is a lot more. Having just been the last 6 days at several meetings, there's Southern Africa, Asia, and that little promontory out there called Europe where some things were interesting, but it's very hard to apply these methods. And it would be interesting to see if one could try to apply some of these approaches to less neat situations even than you have in the very messy and mosaic Rift Valley. And some of the people here, I'm sure Matt and others are going to talk about South Africa. But there's that stuff outside Africa too.
Yeah, and I think that we can these methods apply, maybe not soil carbonates if we don't have them, but the great thing about teeth is that they're there. And I think the concepts that I presented here can be applied to other systems, and the work that Matt and Peter have been doing in South Africa, it's the modern analog work that we need to do, right? And it's the modern analog work for Europe. And I think the models of using a lot of data and coming up with more information for it, that general model that we're starting to develop in East Africa can be developed elsewhere. So I don't know who your Northern European giraffe is and who your Northern European hippo is, but they're out there, right?